everyone out at the house of the Lord this morning. I want to thank each and every one for coming. Pray as always that you come expecting so you'll go receive it. And just thank God for another opportunity to be in His house today. And we're just looking forward to everything that is in store for us this morning. And we definitely want to thank you for coming. So we're going to go ahead at this time and we're going to open up a good word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for this day. We thank you, Lord, for everything that you've done. God, your great many blessings upon us, Lord. We thank you, God, that we're able to be here today. We pray a special blessing, God, this morning for those that were not able to be here. God, we pray for that physical touch, God, that encouragement. God, we pray, Lord, that you just minister to those hearts and lives, God. And I pray this morning that everything that's done and said would be for your honor and glory, that souls would be saved, and God, that people would be encouraged and lifted up, God, and strengthened today. And Lord, we ask everything in Jesus' beautiful name. Amen. 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 Would you turn in your song book to page 489? Page 489, if you're able, would you stand for the singing? Okay.
Still. was bad, the waves hit hard. They thought that they would surely die. Then the master came walking on the sea. Ride him, fear not, it is I. Peter stepped out on the water, and the waves they held him for a time. Looking back as Jesus caught him, I wonder if he might have cried. It's not the first time that he said, there's a hill called Calvary. I was going down last time when he reached out, rescued me. I've had storms in my lifetime, and I thought that I would surely drown. But the nail-scarred hand that caught me, it kept me from going down. So even if it takes a miracle, he still walks upon the water to keep me safe from all harm. So it's not the first time that he saved me, 'cause there's a hill called Calvary. couldn't find anything, and then when I was cleaning on Saturday, God showed me where to take it from, and I
went home and had the outline already. And to be honest with you, I hardly added a thing. And so we just got a general outline today. But they're the good ones because the Lord really fills in in between one thing and another. And so we're going to be in Luke chapter 19 today. We're going to start our reading in verse 35. We'll read to the end of the chapter, which is verse 40. This is a text that you've no doubt heard from before. I may have even preached a sermon out of this text since we've been a church here. I'm not really sure. But nonetheless, this is something familiar to me. This is something that Jesus had spoken to the Pharisees in, when he was entering into Jerusalem. They call it the triumphal entry. This is his last entry into Jerusalem before he would die on the cross of Calvary. And well, you'll see where I'm going. You know, I know where I'm going now, and you don't. So just bear with me this morning when I start to give you a little bit of examples. I'm going to talk about things that you already know, but we'll tie them in spiritually, I promise. And so I hate to state the obvious this morning, but just bear with me for a moment, and we'll get into what God would have for us. But first, we'll go ahead, and if you're able, would you stand with me, if you're able, for the reading and honoring of God's Word. We'll start in Luke 19, verse 35. So the disciples had just went, and they had gotten the donkey that Jesus would ride into Jerusalem on. And so this is where it picks up. And this is why it says, and they brought him to Jesus. That's the donkey. And they cast their garments upon the colt, and they set Jesus thereon. And as he went, they spread their clothes in the way. And when he was come nigh, even now at the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen. There goes your civilized worship right there. Saying, blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. And some of the Pharisees from among the multitude said unto him, Master, rebuke thy disciples. And he answered and said unto them, I tell you that if these should hold their peace, the stones would immediately cry out. Folks, there are just some things the devil can't stop. It's just the way that it is. The devil will try to hinder, but there are just some things in life that he just can't stop. It does not matter what he tries to do. It does not matter what he says. There are some things that he just cannot stop. So this morning we're going to talk about spiritual gravity. Spiritual gravity. Father, we love you. God, we thank you for this day. Sweet Spirit of God, we thank you for your presence and your dealing with hearts today. I thank you, God, for your power, Lord, this morning. God, that I've been able to feel your presence in this place. God, I'm thankful there's a place we can come to be refreshed, God, from the things we adore in this life. God, let everything that's done and said here today be for your honor and glory. Let souls be saved. Let those, God, that need it be touched this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. This portion of Scripture, as I said, it covers the account of the triumphal entry of Christ into Jerusalem. And, you know, you've probably heard that verse. Jesus said, I tell you that if these should hold their peace, that the rocks, or the stones, it says, would immediately cry out. You know, that tells me that God is so worthy of praise that if you and I don't do it, an inanimate object will. You know, God created stones and He created you and me. But, you know, God is worthy of praise, and the devil can't stop God from being praised. He may be able to shut you up, but something is going to praise God anyways. So it might as well be us, really. And so we'll just see here. Now, I looked up gravity, and you've learned the concept of gravity probably at a young age. Gravity is what takes that to the floor. And you and I, we don't feel the effects of gravity, but we feel the effects of trying to overcome it. You know, when you jump, you're only going so far until you're heading the opposite direction again. When you fall, you're falling as fast as an object that weighs a ton. It doesn't matter. You're falling as fast as anything else because of gravity. And I find it really look something up. You know, I weigh 185 pounds, approximately. It just depends how good I eat one day to the next. I weigh 185 pounds. You know, if I was on the moon, I would weigh 30.7 pounds. Because the moon is smaller than the Earth, it has less gravity. Now, the sun, being very much larger, would put me at 5,180 pounds if I could stand on the sun. So the point is we all want to live on the moon. But that concept is the greater the mass of an object, the stronger the gravity it has. So I want to talk to you about heaven's gravity and Earth's gravity. There's two different gravities every day of your life that pull at you. There's the world's gravity, and then there's heaven's gravity. And we have a pulling in two different directions. We have a pull towards heaven as Christians, and we have a pull towards the earth. And the earth tries to pull the Christian down. And there's things like the Pharisees here, their picture of the earth's gravity. They're trying to stop the disciples from praising God, which is a heavenly pull. That heaven pull to them. There's something in them that's pulling them to want to worship and praise God. And so, there's just a few things we want to look at here today. The Pharisees, they're religious. And you know what? Religious people do not like people that have real relationships. Real relationships with Jesus Christ, because they're emotional. Many times they're emotional. Religious people are not. They think it's not okay to cry when you get blessed. It's not okay for someone every now and again to raise their hand to praise God or to say amen, because that's just not something that we do. You know, that's an earthly pull to try to get you and I to stop those things. The Pharisees, they told Jesus, say, Master, rebuke thy disciples. They were trying to pull the disciples down from doing what they felt in their heart they needed to be doing. It says they began to rejoice. And praise God, it says, with a quiet voice. It says with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen. I find today that people root more for the Super Bowl and louder. They go crazy. You know what? Those players can't hear you. But you're a shouter now. You're saying, run! Run! And you know what? They run faster when you say that. Not really. You know what? You've seen some of your children play sports. There's nothing wrong with shouting. Go on, run! You know what? They probably can't hear you. They're in the zone. They're running like every now and again some of them can. But you know, when they're in the midst of hitting each other, knocking each other down, and you're on the sideline red faced, screaming like crazy, probably they can't hear you. But you're still shouting. You know what? But when you praise God, God hears you. He hears you when you shout His praises. He hears you.
Amen.
I plan on watching the Super Bowl, but I ain't going to stand up. And I ain't going to be like, go, go, go. I'll be like, give me some more food. That's what I look forward to. Pass me the Mountain Dew. Of course, I'll be doing that after church. Halfway through is when they play harder anyway. I don't need to watch the beginning. I just watch the end, because that's when it gets interesting. They ain't got the drive to get real like they do at the end. But I just want to talk to you about three things. Really, where the world pulls you one way and heaven's pulling you another. Folks, you and I have a choice to make. I know if you're saved, you've already made the greatest choice, but that doesn't mean that your choices are over. Romans chapter 7, Romans chapter 6, Paul says, there's a pull there. There's a pull there. You got a choice. You're going to walk in the flesh, you're going to walk in the spirit. The flesh is trying to pull you here, but the spirit is pulling you there.
Amen.
There's a choice that you have to make. And I'm telling you, every choice that we make, it has a consequence. It has an outcome that affects you and others. The first thing is we start right off with exactly what were happening to the disciples. They were worshiping God. They were worshiping. Verse 37, it says, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they seen. Master rebuked thy disciples, said, listen, they're getting a little too loud. They ought not to be saying what they're saying. They said, rebuke thy disciples. Jesus said, I'm not going to rebuke them. They're doing exactly what they're supposed to be doing. But the world says, you need to hush up. They're being too loud. They ought not to be doing what they're doing. And I find it's the same way today. People, listen, I preached a sermon one time, and a lady, she said, you're just trying to make people, it seems to me that you're just have a lot of open interpretation, because I didn't stand like a 6-foot icicle and say, would you turn with your Bibles, please, now? And I went to her, you know what, I got angry, I'm not going to lie, I got mad. Because I went like this, but she probably couldn't tell I was mad, but I wanted to choke her out. I said, let me show you something. I said, here's a verse of scripture. I said, everything that I told you today, I said, I quoted God's word. I said, I might not have said John chapter 19, verse 40. I said, but I quoted what John chapter 19, verse 40 said. Amen. I wanted to tell her, if you had any lick of knowledge of the word of God, you'd know that. Amen. But I said, listen. I said, I understand. Listen, the way that I preach just isn't for everybody. But listen, if I had to preach the way that everybody wanted me to, I'd be like this 1 minute before I stopped. I'd have to be reserved. And I'd have to be more toned down. I can't help. Listen. I can't help the way that I am. There's a pull within me that I get excited when I start talking about God and how good God's been. There's a pull in me to worship God. Sometimes I sit there and I just get the feeling. I start getting the goosebumps. I don't always stand up. And I don't always lift a hand when I feel like it. But I think I'm about to start doing it every time. And it doesn't matter if it scares someone or not. There's something about when I think what God's done for me. Even in the midst of trial. Even in the midst of storm. That makes me want to praise Him anyway. There's a heavenly pull that I feel. And you know what? If we shut that pull down eventually, you won't have that pull no more. There ought to be something within you that stirs you. That doesn't mean you've got to stand up and say, woo! Some of y'all get scared to death if someone does that. Why? Why would you get scared? You know what? Do you remember what Jesus said when that woman got down on her hands and knees and she started to wash him? His feet with her hair. They scoffed at that act of worship. They said, what is she doing? Why are you letting her do this? She's a sinner woman. You know what he said? He says, he that's been forgiven much loves much. Now I'm not sitting here gauging people's love on how, if they're loud in service or not, but I'm telling you what. A lot of times you'll see someone who's in tune with how good God's been to them, and they will raise a hand every now and again. They will acknowledge that God's been good to them every now and again. They won't be afraid every now and again to testify about something that's God's done. I know there's a pull that tries to get us to be quiet. There's a fear that the devil tries to get us to shut up. Master, rebuke thy disciples. But there's also a pull that just makes me want to do it. I can't help, but guess what? The closer you get to the sun, the more you feel its pull. The further away you get from the earth. Listen, if you would just get dropped in outer space and you would be equal to the distance to the sun and in earth, and you'd be in the middle, guess what? The sun would pull you in. The further away you are from the earth, the more you feel the gravity of the sun. And listen, that's the same way spiritually. The further away you get from the earth, the more the pull of the sun, S-O-N, that you're really going to feel. And when someone starts talking about how good God's been, I'll tell you what, there'll be something within you that starts pulling you to want to just bless His name some way, somehow. The world says it's undignified to cry, it's undignified to shout or to lift your hand or to praise God. Listen, I am nothing against someone who's not that way. I'm not going to tell you you have to be. Don't misunderstand me today. I'm not. But you better be praising God somehow, some way, in some way, shape, or form. You ought to be thanking God for how good He's been.
and all his many blessings. It says, for all the mighty works that they had seen. They were thinking about everything they'd seen Jesus do. And when they thought on those things, they couldn't help but start rejoicing and praising God. Insomuch they got that excited that they started with a loud voice to do those things. God's been too good to me to shut up. He's been way too good for me to sit here and just keep quiet when I hear a song sung about His goodness, or to keep quiet when I start feeling that pull.
Amen.
You know what? I feel that pull on my spirit when my flesh is weak. When I'm tired, when I'm sick, when I'm worn out, when I feel like I'm surrounded by the enemy, that pull's still there. The enemy's trying to get me to shut up. He's trying to get me not to worship God. Sometimes I'll say, well, what's people going to think? I don't care. I don't want to care. I don't want to even think about wanting to care, even for a second. I just want to thank God and praise God for how good that He's been in our lives and in this church. When we think about all the mighty things that He's done, there ought to be a pull somewhere on your heart that gets you want to praise God. I can feel heaven's pull every time I think about the mighty works that I've seen.
Amen.
A young boy walked up and said to an old sailor, he says, what's the wind? Just what is the wind? That old sailor looked at him and says, well, son, he said, I can't tell you what the wind is. He said, but I can tell you how to hoist a sail. And you know what? You know what we do? I'm guilty of it too. We'll sit here and wait until our pump done been primed and we start really feeling it before we'll lift a hand and praise God. You know what? It don't say, yes, I'll tell you this. When the Bible says that God inhabits the praises of Israel or His people, God inhabits the praises, guess what? That means you got to hoist your sail before the wind comes. That means when you start hoisting that sail of praise, guess what? You'll feel the wind come. That's what happens. You'll feel the Spirit of God show up. The presence of God will inhabit the praise of God's people.
Amen.
That doesn't mean wait till the wind comes, then hoist the sail. That means hoist the sail first, then the wind will come. You want to see God show up in this church? You want to see God show up and stir like crazy in the midst of the service? You ought to praise God before you ever feel like praising God, because you already know He's worthy. The second thing is, it's not just the heavenly pull in the worship, but also in the walk.
Amen.
They were following Jesus into Jerusalem. You know something I don't agree with today? And you may not agree with me, but you do have a right to be wrong this morning. The disciple. The word disciple. Today, people think that all you got to do is make a disciple. Well, that's fine. How do you make a disciple? You don't just, someone doesn't work into salvation. They don't just gradually progress until finally they're saved. No, listen, you become a disciple once you get saved. That's how it is. That's the way that it works. There's never a disciple before salvation. That's not how that is. You need to be a child of God before you're considered a disciple. Listen, they had a walk and they was following Christ. You can't follow Christ unless you're saved. You know why? Because a disciple is somebody. Literally, it means one who follows one's teaching. How can we be a disciple if we don't follow whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved? And God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him shall not perish but have everlasting life. How can we be a disciple until we've already followed the teaching? Meaning accepted Christ. I've had people already say, hey, we're just trying to make disciples. We're just teaching. We're making disciples. That's not all you have to do. Yes, we need to teach them about Jesus, but they're not disciples until they've been saved.
Amen.
But they had a walk. The Pharisees did not like the fact that people followed Jesus Christ. Did not like that fact at all. Not even for a moment did they like that Jesus had disciples. People that followed Him, that loved Him, that honored His teaching. The world pulls you and I to be lukewarm.
Right. Yeah, that's right.
It does. Prove it. Thank you for asking. Where ever to turn to the left or the right. If you can find it, then I will recant what I said from the pulpit. But I ain't worried about it.
That's right. Amen.
You won't find it. God says that you and I need to follow Him with all of our heart. But you know what the problem is? There's the worldly pull. The world pulls you and me to be lukewarm. The world says you just need to be hit and miss every now and again when it comes to serving God. The world will pull us never to read our Bible. The world will say, well, every now and again, it's fine. The world does the same thing with a prayer life. It says, listen, you just got to pray every now and again. You don't need to get real serious about this stuff. You don't need to. And the world will pull even our church attendance and say, well, listen, you don't have to go really all the time. Well, listen, the truth of the matter is you don't have to, but you'll be lukewarm.
Amen. That's right.
Lukewarm. You can't be faithful to God and then hit the brakes and not get lukewarm. There's no way. You can't be lukewarm and then speed up and stay lukewarm. You can't. 100%. It's impossible. That's what the world wants. There's a pull. That's why, listen, there's always something that shows up on Wednesday night and Sunday night. Always. There's always something that shows up. When it's time that you want to sit down and read your Bible, your phone will blow up. You know what you need to do when you're fixing to pray and read your Bible? Put your phone in another room and turn it on silent.
Amen.
Someone's always going to call you.
Amen.
You know how many times I get ready to pray,
yeah,
and I stick my phone over here and I'm praying on my knees and I hear, burr, 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 burr. Guess what? I reach over and turn it off. I don't answer my phone. If I'm going down and praying, and if I'm driving down the road praying and someone calls me, I might look who it is, but guess what? You're going to have to call me back if it's an emergency because I ain't fixing to answer when I'm trying to pray.
Amen.
So I'm telling you now, it's true. There will always be something. Just how far do you want to go with Jesus?
Yeah. Okay.
The world's always going to pull you and I. Guess what? There will always be something that's holding us back. It don't matter if it's your own family. There's always going to be something that's holding you back from serving God. It's a worldly pull. But heaven is pulling me to be here. It's pulling me. You know, I don't come to church 3 times a week because I'm the pastor. I come to church every opportunity that I have because I'm a child of God.
Amen.
And why would I not want to associate myself with being in God's house every chance I get? We get sick. It's a perfect example. We get sick. You can't help that. You can't help that. That's why my daughter has strep throat and she ain't here today sharing it with everybody. There's times, God, just stay home. That's right. I'm your pastor. I told you. There's times you're sick. You ought to just stay home until you get better. But there are times that we could be here and we won't. Because we need to go do this and we want to go do that. We need to catch up on doing this around the house. I'm telling you, God will never bless you for putting 1 ounce of your life ahead of Him.
Amen.
Never. You will not receive God's blessing whatsoever. There's a pull on our life. Heaven pulls us to holiness. It pulls us to let go of the things of the world. Heaven's pull. I was talking about the other day. There's still pull. I'm not going to lie to you. Don't. What I'm about to tell you, I'm just being honest. There was a time in my life that I was a loser. There was. You know what? This is how the devil works. Every now and again, he'll try to come to me and say, boy, you remember how good that tastes? But guess what? The pull to heaven's a whole lot greater.
Mm-hmm.
I said, it don't matter.
Yeah.
Now it's me and Mountain Dew and Jesus. I don't listen. When God saved me, He took the hog out of me. I don't got to slop Him anymore. That's just the way that it is. But every now and again, there's a pull that tries to get me to go a different way. And I'm not going that way because the pull to heaven is greater. I don't need to run around with people that do that anymore. Now I'd rather hang with y'all. And listen, you love me and care for me anyway. And I feel the same way about you. If I had a choice in this life to go to my own family reunion or be here, I'd be here with you instead. Why? Because that means we're here in God's house together. And we're living for the Lord. And we're worshiping God. I wouldn't want to be any other place in this life than right here.
Yeah.
Amen.
The The world pulls you and me to not have a faithful walk. Listen, you ought to just grab yourself up by your bootstrap and just dig in. It feels a whole lot better just to serve God. It really does. There's a pull for me to live separate from this world. There's a pull. I have a drawing in my soul that wants me to have nothing to do with the sins of this world. I still fall short. I still make wrong decisions still. But there's a pull in me not to. I'm not going to reason. I'm not going to reason myself into unfaithfulness to God. I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it. And the last thing is the witness. Verse 38, they were crying out. They said, "Blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." That's out of Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9, I think. It's out of Zechariah 9. The Pharisees wanted them to keep quiet, to be silenced. But Jesus said, if these should hold their peace, the stones would immediately cry out. There was a pull on the disciples to witness. They did not care that they were surrounded by people going into a city where many people did not approve of following Jesus Christ. They were going to a place that they knew that wanted to kill Jesus. That's what the Jews wanted to do, the scribes, the Pharisees. That's what they wanted to do. They wanted to end Christ. But you know what? Even in that hostility, they still were testifying for Jesus. Still witnessing for the Lord. There was a pull that said, rebuke thy disciples. Meaning, make them stop. And Jesus said no.
Amen.
You know why he said no? Because they were obeying the heavenly pull. They were obeying exactly what they needed to be doing. It was the time that it was to be declared that Jesus Christ is King. Given the outcome of the election, it seems that people are more bold now in their declaring of speaking of God and Christ in the media and things like that. It seems to me, that it may be just me, but it seems like there's more boldness now. I've heard that cop cars, police cars are putting in God We Trust back on them, and some of them are starting to do that because they feel that they have that ability now that they're not going to get raked over the coals for something like that. That they have that ability now. I don't know. I've not researched that. I know someone who said that they've seen it, and I trust them very much. So technically, I'm quoting what they had told me. I haven't had opportunity to research that. So it may or may not be really accurate. It may just be perception. I'm not sure. But I do know that we live in a day and age when there are certain places that you are that they insist that you are not allowed to talk about Jesus Christ. You know, I heard of a young lady that had said that they had heard their teachers say that you can't talk about church in school. What do you mean you can't talk about church and school? There are places today that's not just school, that are all around, that depending where you're at, they don't want you to acknowledge Jesus Christ. They don't want you to say that. And I just know that now's the time we're supposed to be witnessing more than ever.
Yeah.
That we ought not to feel the suppression of this world when it comes to things. There are places that you and I could be in life, that you might experience those things. I've been that way. I've taken stands. You have too. You've taken stands for the Lord when it seemed like they made you out to be a bad thing because you took a stand for the Lord. Well, don't let that surprise you because the world's heading in a different direction than we are. So why would it not oppose us for taking stands for Jesus? There was a man who was walking down the street one day, and out in front of the house there was a pile of rose bushes. And he happened to notice a little rosebud on one of them bushes. He went on home, and the next day he was making his rounds, taking a walk, and he looked down, and he seen that same little rosebud, and it didn't look like it was dying. It still looked like it had life in it. So he went home, he got some gloves, he went back, and he sorted the rose bushes out, and he got this rose bush that had that rosebud on there, and he went home, and he planted it. And it actually took off. He actually planted other rose bushes later that never did as good as this one, and it always seemed that every year this thing flourished, and there was one rosebud that popped out and was taller and bloomed, and that one rose that was taller than everything else on that same bush. It took off when he planted it. Folks, God does the same thing with your witness. You might think in your home, in your workplace, you might think that you're the only one, but guess what? Because of that one rosebud, that whole bush was saved.
Amen.
You know, because of that one that's still going to hold to Jesus in the church house, that's still going to hold to Jesus in the workplace, that's still going to hold to Jesus in their home, that's still going to hold to Christ no matter where they're at, because of that one, many times whole families get saved. So it might be that the devil's pulling you down and trying to get you to stop serving God and stop witnessing, but you ought to just get even more purpose that you are going to not obey this worldly pull, and you're going to let the pull of heaven take you to where you're supposed to be. And you watch, God will take your one, that one rose petal that you are, that one blossom that you are, and you'll start looking around after time when people start getting saved, and you'll see the difference that God allowed you to make in your home, in your workplace, and in your life.
Amen.
You'll look around and you'll see other rosebuds blooming because people will get saved. It is impossible for you, being a true witness for the Lord, that somebody ain't going to get saved every now and again. It'll just happen. It may not be every year, but you are constantly making a difference for the Lord, no matter where you're at, when you are being a witness for Him. But it's hard for us to be a witness if we ain't walking the way that we're to walk. You know, because the worldly pull is real. Folks, it is.
Amen.
The worldly pull is real. You don't realize sometimes how easy it is just to step back. But when we do that, or let out of Bible reading, it's easy just to skip it today. It's easy just to not pray today. It's easy just to skip church this time. Because when you do it once, it gets easier. And you don't realize that you're getting pulled by the world. That heavenly pull's still there, but guess what? You're closer to the world now. And the closer you get to the world, the greater the pull of the world on you. But the closer you get to the Son, the less the world's pull. That's why you can't live in sin. You have to either live closer to the world or closer to the Son. And God calls us to live close to the Son, to obey heaven's pull. There's a pull for us to worship God. There's a pull for us to walk with Him. And there's a pull for us to witness. The same as that pull exists from heaven, this world has a pull against all that. Today, maybe if you're feeling the pull, folks, I encourage you that you come, and that you tell the Lord, no more. No more. I'm going to do my best to break this, just to turn away from the world's pull. God put the pull of heaven on me so strong and helped me just to get closer to Him. That's what we need today. The closer it gets to the return of Christ, I'm telling you now, the harder it's going to be for you and I. It's going to be harder. We need to be as close as possible because you know what? If you're not walking close with God, you'll get torn to pieces. You will. You know what? When a sheep gets away, this is true. When a sheep gets away from its flock, from the shepherd, and it realizes that it's lost, looks around, you know what they say a sheep will do? It'll lay down. And it will not move. That sheep will stay there where its flock. It will stay there where it's astray. It will stay there. It just gets down. The shepherd has to go. They get helpless. They don't know what to do. They get down. You know what? The world pulled it out. Got it down. And now it sits there. That's why we need to stay close to the shepherd. Because God forbid we get to a place where we're just out. And there we lay. The shepherd comes a-looking. He does. He comes a-looking. blessing is. That's where the joy is. That's where the peace is. I'm telling you. If you got a pull, it's not heaven. It's time to end that. You may always have that pull, but I'm telling you, if you draw nigh to the Lord, that pull gets lesser. It gets lesser because you're closer to Him. If everyone bow their head and close their eyes for just a moment. I have given you what God has put on my heart for this morning. I cannot make one soul respond today. That's not my responsibility. It has merely been to give you.